interesting quantum states by applying dissipation in a controlled way. The same mechanism that allows you to prepare certain quantum states very often is connected to an attractor dynamics that automatically brings you to the state. So it's a very easy way of creating states, which then can, of course, also be stabilized if you deviate from that state. Now, I already mentioned, in our case, we will deal with losses, and that will lead to imaginary parts in your Hamiltonian. So you get in touch with non-Hermitian Hamiltonians, and you can see whether you can observe such effects maybe in experiments with ultra-cold atoms. And when you have an open system, so you do something with your system, there is the question of how to define phase transitions in this system. And finally, whenever you have drive and dissipation as here, there is very naturally connected a transport of particles or a transport of heat or a transport of everything. So transport is a quite generic property of open systems. So these are kind of the different questions that we want to address. And particularly today, I would like to introduce to local loss. Here is a toy model. It's a leaky optical lattice. You have a think of a Bose-Hubbard model where you have atoms tunneling around and some lattice sites are dissipative in a sense that you lose atoms from those sites. If you want to describe this system theoretically, you go to a master equation approach. So your density operator evolves with your normal Bose-Hubbard Hamiltonian, but then you have this super operator here, which has in a master equation with Markovian assumptions this form here. And the essential part is that you have operators here that determines what your quantum system is doing when it's coupled to the environment. And in our case, where we are concentrating on losses, this means that these are the annihilation and creation operators of atoms in the wells. And what you see in front of this here, gamma, this is the rate at which these operators are applied. So essentially, it's the loss rate, so how fast or how the probability decays exponentially in time. If you have a closer look on that, you can also see it from that perspective in the connection of non-Hermitian Hamiltonians. If you combine your normal Hamiltonian time evolution that you have in your system, and now you have this additional coupling, which has this form here, then you see that from these two terms here, in case of losses, you can construct this effective Hamiltonian here, which tells you you have your normal Hamiltonian, but here you have an imaginary potential, which then describes the losses. That's the level at what I will show you experimentally, so that's kind of a mean field approximation of that, but I would like to point out that one important point is missing here, and this is that part here, and these are the quantum jumps where you lose an atom or you don't lose an atom. And we haven't yet seen this in the experiment, the effect of this, because in order to see that, you really have to be sensitive of I lose an atom or I don't lose an atom. So you really have to go down to the kind of single particle resolved measurements. We are not yet there, but this, of course, is something we are very interested at the end. But here you can see how an imaginary potential pops up from this type of master equation. Now, if we go back to the mean field description, then if we just leave the Bose-Hubbard model but just go to a mean field level, then we have a Josephson model here where n is the different lattice sites here, and between the lattice sites you have tunneling coupling J, you have an interaction energy, and one of the sites in our case will be dissipative, so we'll lose atoms. You can also write down the equation of motion for the 3D system, and then your atom loss translates also into an imaginary potential. So what you see here is the Kross-Peterjewski equation with this imaginary potential. So this is a way to describe what happens if you have a condensate where you lose atoms at a certain point R with a certain rate gamma. The way we are doing these losses is electron microscopy, a very special technique promoted in our group. We have a focused electron beam that intersects the ultra-cold quantum gas. And whenever the electron beam hits an atom, the atom is kicked out, and to some extent, or with some probability, it is ionized. So essentially, you shoot out atoms. You shoot with a gun on your condensate. And this happens at very small spatial distances. In the order of 100, 150 nanometer, that's the typical diameter of the electron beam. It's a single atom sensitive method because when you have created an ion, you can immediately detect it with an ion detector. So we have an electric field. The ion goes in the detector, it makes click. It has a limited fidelity, this process. This I have to admit, and that's also the biggest disadvantage of this technique. So it's about 10 to 20%, so not very good. It's a 2D imaging, so we integrate along the line of sight. It only works in situ. We cannot make time of flight because then the electron beam doesn't hit the cloud anymore. And what is important, the most important feature for today, and I would also say for this whole technique, is the fact that you can locally probe your gas, you can remove atoms, you see what you remove because you have these ions that come out of your cloud, and still the rest of your condensate is still living. So it's still doing some quantum dynamics. So you don't interrupt your, you don't have to interrupt your experiment at a certain point, and then you just look at, well, the density distribution of the whole cloud. You can really probe it locally. And it's very, very useful. This is just to show that you can also use this as an imaging tool with optical lattices. These are typically averages over many experimental runs to get such an image. And we typically also have many more than one atom per lattice site here. The size here, the lattice constant in all these images is 600 nanometers. So that gives you an idea of the resolution capabilities of this technique. Now let's go back to the physical system that we want to study. It's a Josephson junction array, and that is, I guess, it's really a very, very famous setting in for Bose-Einstein condensates. It goes back to my good friends in Florence here in 2001, where you put a condensate into a one-dimensional optical lattice. So you take a cigar and you cut it into slices. And that is then, an array of individual condensates tunnel coupled to each other. Now, our dissipation comes now in the following way. We are removing atoms from one lattice site here with the electron beam. And I want you that you consider the left and the right part of this system as kind of a reservoir where atoms can tunnel into that site here. Here is again the basic setting here. You remove atoms here, and then the question is, what is happening? If you just do this experiment for the first time, and for us it was quite surprising to observe that essentially nothing is happening. So this is the experimental result. This is time in milliseconds, and here, here we show the ion rate that we extract from this site, and we convert this into a filling level. So filling level of one means there is the same filling of this site compared to t equals zero. And that also means if the filling level is one here, it has the same atom number than all the neighboring sites. So what you see here is that essentially, even though you remove atoms here, the site remains its filling. So the losses from the sites are immediately balanced by a superfluid flow of particles coming from left to right. So you don't create a hole or anything like that. So the particle transport is a purely superfluid transport. And you can understand that if you just look at the mathematics of the of this Josephson model. And the Josephson model here again, this is what we think describes our system. You can look for stationaries, for steady states. So you just put this to zero and you can ask whether you can find this situation. It's covered by this equation. And indeed, you find steady states that look like that. You have a constant phase gradient from one well to the other on one side, but also on the other side. That's why you have the modulus here. And if your phase difference between neighboring sites fulfills this condition here, where gamma is the loss rate in the central site and J is the tunneling coupling, then you can show that you have a solution to this where you have the same amplitude everywhere. Right. In a band structure, you can think of it that you create these momentum states here which transport particles. And you have two solutions. One is this one and the other one is the band edge. So that one is unstable, so what we observe is this one here. So the basic phenomenology is clear. However, we want to look a little bit more into the details of that. So this is now a plot that shows you, if you increase the loss rate, what this steady state level is doing. And for low dissipation rate here, for low losses, you see that it remains stable in time. So there is nothing, so this whole mechanism works, there's superfluid response, but then at some point it drops down. You can also see it on this individual trajectory, so this you've already seen here, some data point up there, where the filling doesn't change, and here there is a decay of atom number, which means that now the atoms cannot flow so fast into that site, and you really dig a hole with your local losses. This point will become important at the very end, so keep that in mind, that there is kind of a change from something like everything works well and you have this constant amplitude solution to something that decays in time. Now let's, just as a side remark, let's have a brief look that the system has quite some interesting internal microphysics. Here I show you an experiment where we do essentially exactly the same as before. The only difference is that we start from an initially empty site. So we remove it, we empty it with the electron beam, and then we let the dynamics going on. These are the red points here. And you see that for small dissipation, this initially empty site just fills up to roughly a level of the same level as all the other sites, and then it remains in the steady state. So we have two different initial conditions, but you end up here for some time in the same steady state. This is not always the case. If you study this systematically, this is again the dissipation rate gamma here, and I've shown you the blue points already, and the red points are now the trajectories that we observe when we start from an initially empty site. For small gamma, it also fills up completely. Maybe that's not surprising. But here there is a window of bistability where you can really see stable, steady states with different filling levels in that site and that are stable, at least on the timescales we can observe it in the experiment, and that opens up this bistability region here. The reason for that, I don't want to go into the details here. The reason for that is that we have an extended lattice site, so we have interactions. We have to look how the single particle states look like, and in that we can understand this phenomenology by realizing that the effective tunneling coupling from the full site into an empty site is reduced because the single particle wave functions do not match, and that's the basic origin of this bistability here. There is also the question that you can address: what is the connection between the left world here and the right world here? So the left world here means superfluid transport from both sides. You just have a condensate in all the sites. Here on the right, you have some kind of normal states where they decay, and somehow they must be connected. And you already see one connection is this point, which then immediately drops. I will come back to that later. Another point is marked with a yellow star here. We think that what's happening here for half-filled sites is that at this point here, there might be a question mark here, so there might be a non-equilibrium phase transition where if the dissipation rate gamma is larger than this value, there is not a possibility that a condensate can be produced in this site because the losses are too strong, but below there are. And the connection between these two points is that there is a slowing down of the time scale at which this happens here. Okay, we can also look at the final phase diagram of all this by plotting the gamma world versus the tunneling coupling. If the tunneling coupling dominates, there is always this superfluid transport here. If gamma dominates, it's kind of a normal state, so some atoms drop into that site and are removed, and there is this bistability region in between where we always see this yellow feature, as I have explained. Now, keep that in mind for a few minutes, and I will now explain to you first a different topic, and then I will make the connection to what we have observed now in the experiment. This is now something that comes from the optical world. It's called an effect that is called coherent perfect absorption. What it is kind of an extension of critical coupling, but to a situation where you have two laser beams which impinge on an absorber in exactly that way. So you have an absorber here. You can think of these two layers maybe as mirrors and some absorbing material in between. Now you have a laser beam that comes from the left. You have one that comes from the right. And you can ask, is it possible that you have zero transmission and zero reflection? In other words, that these two parts of your scattering process do not exist at all. If this is the case, then you call this coherent perfect absorption. So you call it perfect absorption because all the light is absorbed. And as you will see, you call it coherent, because to make this work, the two laser beams have to have the same phase. So it really depends on how the phase is. If the phase changes, you lose this condition. That was just as young as 2010, as this was pushed forward by Doug Stone. It can be observed with lasers, very straightforwardly. You choose a laser, you split it into two parts. One way goes this, so the central element is a silicon wafer here. The other one is you go to the right and you have the two impinging fields, and then there is exactly the argument that I made. And coherent perfect absorption means that the transmitted part of one laser beam destructively interferes with the reflected part of the other laser beam. And there you can understand how only you have only incoming waves, and you can monitor this in the detectors. The important point is that you need matching parameters. I will come back to that in a second. Now, from a mathematical point of view, what is usually done is you describe this scattering experiment with a transfer matrix. That's in 1D a nice concept that relates the two amplitudes of the left side here with the amplitudes of the right side. So how much is transferred from one side of the scattering problem to the other side. And if you describe this with this matrix, then the coherent perfect absorption simply means that this matrix element is 0, M11, and then it immediately follows that AR and BL are 0. So these are just these two parts here. There is another nice connection, which is formally achieved if M22 is 0. In that particular case, you have AL and BR 0, which means this one is 0 and this one is 0. And then you essentially have a situation where this acts as a laser, which emits radiation in both directions. You can have this if you, of course, you cannot do this with an absorber, but you need a gain medium, and then exactly you have that. This is called sometimes spectral singularity, and CPA is sometimes also called time-reversed spectral singularity. Now, what works with light beams, of course, also should work with matter waves. And here is our Josephson model. So first, we switch off the interactions, and we look if we can find similar solutions. And we assume that this absorber is now one lattice side in the Josephson model. So one lattice side is dissipative. So you see we are approaching the experiment. And the two incoming radiations are just matter waves that move through the optical lattice. And then you can, from this model, you can directly compute the transfer matrix here. And you see this coherent perfect absorption means that this guy becomes 0, and this means that you have to fulfill this condition here. And this is exactly the same condition, of course, that we had before when we were looking for the steady states of the Josephson model. So it's not a surprise that this is the result. Maybe it's a surprise because it's a nonlinear, non-interacting limit. But the important point here is that these three quantities, J, the tunneling coupling, the quasi-momentum, and the loss rate, they have to match each other. You can choose one of them, two of them, and the third has to match. And that was also the difficulty to observe this in the experiment, because with your lasers, you really have to see that the silicon wave is at the right position, that the phases match, and that the wave vector matches to the absorption and all this. Now, we can also ask the question if the same phenomenon is possible if we have nonlinear waves. Now, the nonlinear waves are quite natural in our setting. We just have to add the interaction energy here. And you can just show by explicit construction, because you cannot easily write down scattering matrices and all that for the nonlinear system, but you can show that exactly the same condition, as you already know, fulfills this criterion. So for this criterion, you have this coherent perfect absorption. Now, the big difference here is, what I want to stress is that in the experiment, what we do is we set some J, that's the lattice height that we do, and then we simply switch on gamma, so we switch on a certain loss rate. And the corresponding quasi-momentum state, Q, which you need to fulfill this condition, is automatically established by the superfluid response. So this is an example how you get an attractor dynamics, and you immediately get this solution without further taking care of anything. That does not work in the linear case. It's only a property of the nonlinear case here. So the experiment you have already seen, it's kind of a reinterpretation of the experimental results. So we start here absorbing one lattice side, and we observe here the filling, and we also did here some numerical simulations with a Josephson model that also tell you that everything remains full. So have a look at that paper here that was done in collaboration with Vladimir Konotop and Dima Zuzulin. Now, the last few minutes, I would like to try to give you an idea maybe in which direction this can go in the future. There is a whole, I was 1 year ago, I was at the conference of PT symmetric Hamiltonians. I was quite surprised. There's a lot of theory around and not many experiments actually. So let me give you some idea of what it is. The paradigmatic model that you study in this PT symmetric community is that when you have a double well potential and there is an atom allowed, atoms, non-interacting atoms are allowed to tunnel between the lattice sites. And now, so this is the tunneling coupling J, and now you have a coherent pump into that, or let's say a gain plus I gamma, and you have minus I gamma, a loss rate in the other well. So one well, you fill in some particles, from the other you extract them. It's PT symmetric because if you make the the parity conversion, then you exchange actually left. And at the same time, if you make the time reversal, you change the I to the minus I, and then you come to the same Hamiltonian. So that's why this Hamiltonian here, which reflects this one, is called PT symmetric sometimes. To be more precise, it's called active PT symmetric because you have really gain and loss, and sometimes people call this also balanced loss and gain. Now, what is the beauty of these Hamiltonians? As was pointed out in theory first by Karl Bender here, and then many, many work afterwards, is that below a critical gamma value of gamma, the spectrum of such a Hamiltonian is real, which means despite you have a non-Hermitian Hamiltonian, the eigenvalues are real. And this is plotted here, where I show you gamma. This is that value here. And here's the real part of the eigenenergy. And here on that plot, there is the imaginary part of the eigenvalue. And the real eigenvalues, they are first separated. So for gamma equals zero, these two are just the symmetric and the antisymmetric ground states here. And then with increasing dissipation, they merge in this point. During the whole time, for this value of gamma, the imaginary part is zero, and then it starts. There is the chemical potential here, and you will see in a second why there is a chemical potential here. So that's kind of the solution, and that's what people intrigues. There is some nice properties of that. It's not only that you have these real eigenvalues. There is also a very interesting point here where these two real eigenvalues become degenerate here. And at that particular point, actually, the eigenstates are linear dependent. You see, if you change gamma a little bit around this point, you see that the eigenvalues immediately separate. So that has been used with coupled oscillators to make very sensitive detectors. As soon as your gamma is changing a little bit, you can detect it because your system separates much, much faster than at an avoided crossing, for instance. And also the time evolution, if you prepare the system here, is quite special. So is this just a mathematical concept that, or let's say that can be observed? Well, no, let's directly ask the question. Can we do it in the experiment? Knowing that we have now interactions and maybe also quantum fluctuations at the end. And there are immediately two problems. The first problem is, I guess you all agree, there is not a gain in ultra-cold quantum, ultra-cold atoms, at least not an easy gain. And also our drive from the side isn't really a gain, it's a coherent pumping. So we do not simply increase the amplitude of the state there, we just go with a coherent state into that side here. However, there is the way out, and people have pushed forward, that is now passive PT symmetry. If you only have losses in one well, but not in the other, you just take over an overall decay of your particle, and then you have a global decay, and then the rest is here PT symmetric. The second problem is, what about interactions? There is quite some work of Gunnar Wunner's group in Stuttgart, and they seriously consider the question, can you make all this physics also with interacting systems? And they consider the Bose-Einstein condensate in a double well, where the blue is the real potential, yellow is the imaginary potential, so you have gain and loss at the two wells. And then they showed, and here I just show you similar pictures, they showed that indeed this has also the same solution, so it is a PT symmetric system here. We are interested in looking at that, and now I come back to this point where the where the solution that has a stationary state immediately drops. Here I show you again individual trajectories of the steady states for the increasing gamma, and you see that from staying flat, that at some point start to decay until they reach an exponential decay. This is plotted here again. This is the overall decay rate, which is essentially zero when you are in this coherent perfect absorbing state. And then there is some change where you see a decay. And you can already see that close to this point here, there is certainly some kind of interesting time evolution, which we want to study also in the future. And I think that's what we want to go for. So what is the role of interactions? How is exactly such time evolutions look like? And then what hopefully distinguishes us from people that are doing experiments with optical waveguides, there's quite some experiments in this business, is that we might have the chance to also see the influence of quantum fluctuations on this. And that brings me to the outlook now. So can we also get control over this one? What I've shown so far can be understood simply with imaginary potentials. We also would like to use dissipation to create and stabilize many body states, for instance, solitons or vortices. Maybe we can make a new fist on the whole field of non-Hermitian Hamiltonians. And one thing that turns out to be also interesting is Floquet dissipation. So what does it mean? It means that your parameter which controls the coupling oscillates in time. And if this omega matches some other dynamical quantity like the tunneling coupling or whatever, then you might expect some resonance phenomena. These are the people involved. I thank you very much for the attention.